We light this candle of hope to remind us of the source of our hope and to rekindle our imagination for the work of compassion and justice.
I'll take this end. What's it say? Hope. They told me that I would live, but I didn't believe them. I thought they were just saying it. But when you came in, I realized that they wouldn't send a teacher to a dying boy to work on irregular verbs and dangling participles. Their words were not enough. It took the actions of that tutor to make all the difference. The boy saw undeniable proof that he would live. And then he believed it himself and had hope. Actions can speak louder than words. As the 19th century author George Isles once said, hope is faith holding out its hand in the dark. Or as author Sharon Gardner says, hope is the bulb we plant in the darkness, believing that it will burst forth with new life when the light begins to emerge. Hope is the sunlight shining through and lifting a dense fog. Hope is having the audacity to work towards peace in the face of violence and war. It's the persistent belief that against all odds, God's light shines in the darkness.
Candle of peace to remind us that God is never absent from us and is always preparing something new.
Oh, what's it say? Peace. Yeah. Peace is our gift today. Do you want to hold it up and show everyone? I read in a book by James Moore, and he said, it began with the Druids in Northern Europe who believed that mistletoe had curative powers, that it could heal lots of things, including separation between people. So when two enemies met under an oak tree with mistletoe hanging up above them, they took it as a sign from God that they should drop their weapons and be reconciled. They would set aside their animosities and embrace one another under the mistletoe.
We light the candle of joy to remind us that when Jesus is born in us, we have joy, and through him there will be everlasting joy on earth.
Joy.
Hello and good morning, church family. Thank you. Today I'm going to be singing a selection, and before I sing the selection, I just want to just give you a little background about why this song is important to me. In this song, the term children also represents each of us as children of God, so it relates. The message of the song reminds us that God wants us to look beyond the exterior and to love one another. Mm-hmm.
Some children see him lily white, the Savior whom we kneel beside. Some children see him lily white, with tresses soft and fair. Some children see him bronzed and brown, the Lord of heaven to earth come down. Some children see him bronzed and brown, with dark and heavy hair. Children see him almond-eyed, the baby Jesus stand beside. Some children see him almond-eyed, with skin of golden hue. Some children see him dark as day, sweet Mary's son, to whom we pray. Some children see him dark as they, and oh, they love him too. Children in each different place will see the baby Jesus' face, like theirs, but bright with heavenly grace and filled with holy light. Oh, each earthly thing, and with thy heart as offering, come worship now the infant King. 'Tis love that's born to night.
And may I present to you a traditionally untraditional Christmas pageant.
Bible. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own homes, their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child.
So Mary and Joseph, you walk slowly up the center aisle.
And while they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child.
So come forward and sit on the chairs.
and she gave birth to her newborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger.
So Mary, you pick up the baby and rock him. Yep.
Because there was no place for them in the inn. Now, in that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night.
So shepherds, you stand up in the center aisle, and just both of you in the middle there. Just stand there.
Then an angel. An angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger."
And now I need all the angels standing up with the shepherds.
And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us."
So shepherds, not the angels, you're going to walk down and stand this side at the platform in the stable. Angels, you're going to sit back down again.
Wait, you're not done yet, are you?
Well, I could keep reading if you wanted me to.
Well, yes, we want the whole story.
Okay, I guess so. Where was I? Okay, so after 8 days had passed, it was time to circumcise the child. And he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. When the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons.
Wait a minute, where are you going with this? Circumcision? Sacrificing turtle doves? Who wrote this?
Luke wrote it. It's the gospel according to Luke, chapter 2. People keep telling me that they want the traditional story, so this year we're taking it directly from the Bible. Straight up, no editing. What could be more traditional than Luke chapter 2 on Christmas Eve, or almost Christmas Eve?
Fine. We all like Luke chapter 2, but we want the rest of the story. We want the innkeeper, the three wise men, and the camels.
There are no animals cooing at the manger in the Bible, and there is no mention of an innkeeper, kind or otherwise.
But there are wise men, three wise men in the Bible. 3 of them in Matthew.
Matthew mentions the wise guys in his story, but they come later. They come when Jesus is toddler age, and they come without camels. Matthew's version is pretty, well, Spartan. There isn't even a stable scene. Would you rather have wise guys and no manger or stable?
Well, no, but we ask for tradition, not biblical literalism. Tradition is the story as it has been told and retold, molded and shaped. Maybe it's not strictly biblical, but it has important meaning for us.
Meaning or nostalgia?
Fair question. I think it goes beyond nostalgia, though nostalgia is its own gift. Each character in our amalgamated story has a particular purpose. Take the role of the innkeeper, for instance. He has an important role. The innkeeper is where we are invited into the story. He is faced with an important question. Does he have room for Jesus? We love to boo and hiss the innkeeper, but really, would we do it any differently? In his shoes, how would we respond?
So, innkeeper, it's your turn now. You go and stand up beside them up there. Come on, come on. Just come and stand beside them. Wrap this around you.
Okay, I get the innkeeper. That's kind of implicit in the story. But the wise guys just don't belong. They're from another story in a completely different time of Jesus' life. They've only been co-opted to introduce the gift thing, fueling our consumeristic fervor.
Okay, I have to admit, the wise men, as we've come to know them, have little semblance to Matthew's story. But as we've come to know them, they represent human diversity, men and women too. That's why we say wise guys instead of wise men. Come from different continents and different ethnicities. And all are drawn to the light, welcomed in Jesus' presence.
So wise guys, come and join the manger scene. And you can give Mary and Joseph your gifts.
Are you going to suggest now that the animals are important too? Some St. Francis blessing of the animals kind of thing?
Maybe. Or maybe the animals in the Christmas pageant are just fun. Some of our kids like to pretend to be donkeys or sheep or cows. And don't you think Jesus would have welcomed them too? Given that Jesus was known for welcoming children, even inviting them to be like children, I can't help but think that the children playing as animals, just for the fun of it, would be enough. But there's also an element of realism that the animals bring, of humility even.
Okay, bring in the animals. Clearly, I'm losing control of this pageant thing.
Yep, it's your turn now. Off you go.
Well, look, they're cute. A definite Kodak moment.
Oh, no.
Oh, sorry.
A definite Kodak moment. But we are quickly losing the point of the pageant.
Now anybody else want to take a picture?
Yes.
Smile.
Okay, now we need angels.
We've got, well, okay, angels, you're supposed to stand up.
Well, angels. You stand up and you come and join the scene.
We've got angels. Luke gave us angels. They're right there in the aisle. And they are, as always, darling. gorgeous.
Okay, right. But in the traditional story...
Whose tradition? If there's nothing else I've learned from this morning's debacle, I've learned the importance of defining tradition.
In the story I remember from my childhood, my tradition, I guess, the angels were at the manger too. And that seems important because angels, fleeting glimpses of the divine, are everywhere. Angels are not bound by time or space. Angels represent the mysterious omnipresence of the divine.
What are you talking about? This is a children's play, not a doctoral thesis.
Okay, point taken. The angels are beautiful. The children dressed up like angels at Christmas Eve are such a precious sight that many of us cry with joy. Can the shepherds come back too? I know they didn't hang around in Luke's story, but we haven't even had their picture taken yet.
And we forgot to take them off, so they're still here.
They're still there. Clearly, I've lost control. I'm feeling like a pathetic Jonathan Toomey held hostage by a precocious child's memory. Why not? Bring on the shepherds, bring on the angels. All of them can be up here.
Mock if you will, but there's still one more piece, the star.
Okay, Star, your turn now. You come up and you stand. See if you can squeeze in behind Mary and hold your star up really high. Let him in behind here. Hold your star up. Another Kodak moment. Smile, everyone.
The star from Matthew's story?
Yes. The star is a timeless symbol of the light that shines in the darkness. The light that the darkness could neither comprehend nor control. A light that shines, enabling us to follow. Okay, I'm done. Really. Of course, we could use the Santa Claus.
No.
So why don't you stay there and we will all sing together Away in a Manger. And I'm sure that many of you have discovered over the years it is through giving that we receive the most joy. While we often enjoy the gifts we are given, there's nothing quite like the deep joy of seeing someone else being deeply touched by a gift that you gave them.
We light the candle of love to remind us of the love of God that surrounds and fills us at all times, but that we recognize in a special way in the Christmas story. There is no greater power than love.
I knew it. He knew it. He got it right. Love.
Hear the news the angels sing.
On Christmas night, all Christians
As American educator and author Maurice Schwartz said, the most important thing in life is to learn to give out love and to let it come in. All I want for Christmas is for Christ to come to you. And now we have a special love-filled moment for you. Thanks to Marion, Wally, and Kate for their participation.
I was there, you know. To be honest, I wasn't in the best of moods. Times were tough. Economic uncertainty, I think the phrase is. And I knew that as a self-employed shepherd struggling to make ends meet, the outlook was as bleak as the winter.
According to the papers, I had it all. I was young, rich, and a member of a royal family, a celebrity with the world at my feet from the day I was born. But somehow I wasn't enough. There was something missing. I just didn't know what it was.
I know that you would think to look at me now, but I played a part that night, in fact, the starring role. I was the one of the main choreographers of the greatest opening ceremony the world has ever seen. Imagine having that on your CD.
And it wasn't just the money or the lack of it. That was getting me down. My wife had recently left me, and my youngest had been caught stealing. I had the whole world on my shoulders.
I had a string of girlfriends, each more glamorous than the other. But still, that happy ever feeling was eluding me. I endeavored to find myself in various ways. You name it, I tried it, but I ended up feeling more lost.
We spent an eternity rehearsing and getting everything just right. I assumed the audience would be a whole host of the brightest and the best, but they turned out to be much more down to earth than that.
I'd been passing the time with some of the other shepherds, huddled around the campfire to keep warm. They were having some stupid argument about who had the biggest flock, but I had other things in mind.
I ended up throwing myself into astronomy, searching the night sky for answers to all my questions. I met some other stargazers, and together we came to know every inch of the heavens above us.
Do you know the best part? The element of surprise. There we were, silently waiting in the wings, and didn't have a clue.
Suddenly, the sky, which had been as black as my mood, burst into the brightest, most brilliant light. It was golden and warm, like the best feelings in the world. The others were terrified, but I just had the sense that finally things were looking up.
And that's when we saw the new star, where no star had ever been before. You couldn't miss it. It lit up the entire sky, and I knew without a doubt that this was what I'd been waiting for.
We were all champing at the bit to start the show, but first, there was a message to deliver.
Out of the light came a figure, like a person, only not a person, if you know what I mean. Radiant is what he was. So radiant, even the sheepdogs didn't dare bark. He spoke to us and told us that a baby had been born in town and we were to go and see him.
Why did we decide to follow the star? I don't know exactly, but when it started moving, we just knew it was leading us somewhere as we needed to follow it.
It was a shame, Lucia. And that was our clue. Ta-da! Out we came, grand finale. Oh, It was the best fun, flying and floating and swooping and swooshing and gliding and singing. And the harmonies were out of this world. I do say so myself.
Now, I know I'm already sounding like I had a bit too much to drink around the campfire, but there were people up there in the sky, thousands of them, flying around above our heads and singing their hearts out, proof, as we needed it, that this message about the baby really meant something.
We were on the road for a long time, the stars always just ahead of us. We never knew what was round the corner, but we were confident we would reach our destination.
It was a shame when we had to stop. I could have gone all night, but in reality, we were just the warm-up act. The headliner was the one that they really needed to see.
So suddenly they were gone, and there we were in the dark, in the silence, a bunch of confused and traumatized middle-aged shepherds. Well, there was nothing for it but to head off for town and find this baby. The others were convinced that if we didn't go, the glorious chorus would be back for round two.
It's funny, when you reach the end of a long journey, I was worried I might be disappointed after investing so much hope in where the star would lead us.
But as I stood outside the room where the baby was,
I thought I'd come all the way.
I might as well at least stick my head around the door
and say to the little one,
welcome to our world.
Our crazy, confused, and messed up world.
But as soon as I saw him,
I felt him say,
I know.
That's why I'm here.
And he has been here all along.
In this sacred season, we have gathered and waited around this wreath, lighting our Advent candles, with the darkness becoming gradually lighter. In the face of hunger, injustice, and despair, we lit the candle of hope. Because conflict is destroying us and so many swords have not yet been remade into plowshares, we lit the candle of peace. In the face of sadness, grief, and loss, we lit the candle of joy. Because hatred has not yet been fully overcome by love, we lit the candle of love. Having lit the candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, this evening the time has come to light the Christ candle. This is no ordinary night. This is not just the birth of a baby boy. This is God with us. This is God within us. This is God refusing to let the darkness rule.
But I want you also to remember how much God loves us by sending us Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, to be with us, to show us how to live.
No bounds. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Just like you love this world, so help me know.
present I want for each of us this Christmas is the presence of Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen. Look around at the light. One candle is but a flicker, but together we create a bright flame of Christ's light in the world. So we're going to keep the lights off and sing together Silent Night. Verse 3 will be unaccompanied, and then we'll have the benediction before we sing the final verse. Silent Night. It says new life.